So I want you to see how well I'm walking here. Because last night I hung out with your elders and your deacons, and they decided to pray for my knee. And yesterday, you guys, I was walking like this. I'm serious. I was really, really in pain. And so, thanks, Lord. Thanks, Lord. There's so many things going on in my heart that I hope I can get to this sermon. I think there's enough of you a little bit older. Who knows what Twitter pate it is? Okay, about half of you. Well, it's from an old Disney movie. Thumper and Bambi. And there's some, who was it? Which animals were in love? But the description of the love feeling that they had towards one another was, they used the word Twitterpated. I have no idea what it really means. All I know, it was just this infatuating love that it's just a great word. Let's all say this together. Twitterpated. Okay, now see, this is so bizarre. That's how God feels about you. And that's what happened to Dave 40 plus years ago. That's what happened to me when I met Jesus. I got Twitterpated. I felt so in love with God. I just began walking around and thinking, the grass is greener. How is the grass greener? The sky is bluer. I was so in love with God and so grateful and thankful for His grace to pluck me out of the brokenness, the bondage, the shame, all the garbage. And, you know, I guess that's kind of God kind of love. I think you never get over that. I actually got Twitterpated at this little, there was a little redhead in Boise, Idaho, and 44 years. She's still cute. Yeah. It's that, and you're enamored with them. You're in love with them. And if you don't have that, if you don't have a love relationship with God, if you see God as a hard man, if you see Him as a taskmaster, a rule keeper, you know, keep the rules, I'm going to thump you with a stick. If in any way you see God in a negative, hard, harsh way, let Jesus come to you today and change your mind. So we're worshiping today. Wow, I was just drinking it in. The sense of God's presence just soaking me. And I felt like God said, there's this battle going on where I am pulling down walls that are lies about who I am, who I really am. The world is communicating, and the devil is using the world, and the devil's working overtime to say that I am less than perfect love, that I am harsh, that I am mean, that I am all these negatives of who God is. That's not who God is. And it's our task. We are the army of love that God is calling to change their minds about who God is. How is this broken world, this loveless, they have a love deficit in their heart. How are they going to see who God really is? Because He's not mad at them. He loves them. He loves them. I actually, been more than once, I said, God, are you sure? You love all humans. You died for all humans? All means what in the Greek? You know? You can't Greek it away. You can't translate it away. For God so loved the whole world, he gave his son. So, see, I can so boldly tell you, God loves you so much. You have not been loved like God has loved you. He's loved you perfectly. I gotta have to get something for my ear. Glue? Anybody got super glue? So, what God gave me to share with you today, as I think about it, I'm going, Lord, this may be the one of the most faith-filled churches I know of. And so I'm talking about growing in faith. It's just like, how does that work? They're believing God for miracles. There's healings going on all the time. The Spirit of God's moving in their midst. And I'm going to tell you how to get more faith. It seems crazy. In Romans 1:17, New King James Version says, "For in it, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith." That phrase, faith to faith, actually one translation says, ever increasing faith. I want to challenge you as a church. I know you're a church that has faith, believes in God. I want to challenge you. There's room to grow. Amen. You can grow in your faith. You can grow in your confidence and your trust in God. You can see God bigger than you see him now. And then he says, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. You know, three times in the New Testament it says that. If God says something once, pay attention. If he says it twice, take notice. If God says the same thing three times, burn it in the brain. Because he really, really means it. He means it the first time, but when he says it three times, it's a game changer. The just, that's you and I, those that are made just, we live by faith. We live. How encompassing is that word live? Is there anything outside of that? No, that's your whole life. Your whole life is lived by faith according to this scripture. So I believe everything in the kingdom of God operates by faith. Everything. This is how it started. In the beginning, God said, and there was. That's some power, isn't it? That's faith expressed. God said it, and then it happened. That's how big our God is, how great he is. That's how the kingdom of God operates. Everything in the kingdom of God. So faith grows. Faith grows. You don't get a download. Bzzz, oh, now I got faith zapping me, and suddenly I have this great faith. No, faith grows. Now, God is the one that initiates faith in us. But how does it happen? We know also that everything on earth is either growing or dying, don't we? How, if God wants our faith to grow, what can we do to increase our faith? And that's what God had challenged me with. How can we cooperate with God? I believe it's God's intention that your faith increase today, that you grow in faith, that something happens in your spirit, that you leave believing God for bigger than when you came. Do you think that can happen? Think God can do that? Absolutely. So let me just give you some nuggets of how I learned about growing faith. First, I think all growth comes in us. All growth, not just faith, but all spiritual growth comes as we get closer to God. The more you see God, really see Him for who He is, the more your faith will grow.
That's right.
Because the more you know what God is really like, the more you're going to trust Him.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
You know, it's interesting. In a lot of denominations, they actually teach in their Bible schools, when you're the leader, you're the pastor, don't get close to people. Don't let people be close and friends. You got to keep this distance, because they might find out who you really are, I guess. But you know, Jesus didn't live that way. Jesus actually hung out with His disciples, ate the same meals, slept on the same ground with them. He was with them, and it changed them. Well, I believe that the more we're with God, the more we become like Him. The most important thing that we can do in our Christian walk is to pursue God with our whole heart. It never ends. I'm as Twitter-pated as when I started. I love Jesus more today. He's more wonderful. I don't know if I'll have the time to share with you about John 11. These days I don't get the opportunity to preach very often, so I get all excited when I get the opportunity to preach. And Lewis and I, we've been going through a series through the book of John, and as the lot happened, just happened to be, our pastor is going to be gone, so he asked me if I wanted to preach. I said, sure. He said, we're continuing the series of John, and you get John 11. That was lucky, wasn't it? I don't believe in luck. God's in charge of the universe. So, I'm preaching in John 11, which is about the resurrection of Lazarus. Now, it's so interesting to me that at the same time, I just found out my younger brother and I is filled with cancer, and the doctors say he's dying. And so I'm thinking about it. My younger brother is dying, potentially dying, and I had another brother die last fall. I'm thinking about this, and I'm reading John 11, and I'm reading about, and I'm thinking about death. I'm thinking about this whole process of dying and how this meeting with Jesus in John 11 was like Jesus nose to nose with death, and who wins? Jesus faces death, not just one day, not just mostly dead. What's the Princess Bride? No, nobody responded to that. In the Princess Bride, this guy died, but he was just mostly dead, not totally dead. In John 11, he's 4 days dead. He's stinking dead. That's really dead. And Jesus faces death 4 days. And how many words does it take him to reverse that? 3 words. And he completely reverses everything in that dead body. And wow, that's amazing. When you think about that, is anybody here just mostly dead? Or anybody 2 days dead? No? Nobody's even close to 4 days dead here, right? So what's your problem? So you got a problem, right? Is it bigger than 4 days stinking dead? No, it's not. Our God is mighty. Our God is unlimited in power. He was nose to nose with death. 3 words, boom. 11 systems in the human body completely reversed. He was drying up there was no air conditioning in that tomb. He's drying up. The blood had drop to the lower parts of the body. He's stiff. His, you know what happens when your brain doesn't get oxygen for hours? Try 4 days. How's your brain going to work now? Didn't bother Jesus, did it? Completely reversed. 4 days of no oxygen to the brain, no blood, nothing. Suddenly, there he is, Lazarus, standing at the door of the grave. Big God. Huge, huge God. Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Lord, I do believe. I think that's most of us. We believe. But Lord, you're so much bigger. Why have we made God so small? The more we get to know him, the more God unpacks who he is, the more we believe and become like him and do what he does. So we need to get to know him better. And how do we do that? Isn't it interesting? I just told you a story out of John 11. And John 11 is where? In the Bible. And faith comes by hearing the Word of God. I think it is interesting. It doesn't say reading. It does say hearing. So there's something powerful about saying it out loud or hearing somebody read it. When I preached in our church, I read that whole passage. I just read the whole passage out loud because I wanted them to hear how big God is. I wanted the Spirit to be able to take that seed of truth and break down the lies of yes, but. God is big, but. God is a mighty God, but my issues, my problems, my challenges, my whatever it is, you're not 4 days stinking dead. He can handle it. Come on. He can handle it. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing, that's Romans 10:17. God's word is the voice of God. It's the food of God for our spirit. In fact, as we begin to let God's word become part of our lives, it actually not only changes us, it changes actually our language. We begin to speak what God speaks. I loved your offering confession. Take that, devil. You know, it's kind of in your face, devil. God's going to bless me. God's favor is on me. He has said. I love that. We need to speak what God speaks. We need to learn the language of faith. We need to hear what he says and do what he tells us to do. So let me give you three illustrations of how faith is a process. It's a growing thing. And just some practical things. Faith is like a spiritual muscle. So you know about physical muscles. What happens when you don't use a physical muscle? Anybody? Atrophy. That means it disappears. So I was actually helping Rhonda, and I was we were moving a big TV for her office, and I was reaching across the inside of the car and went, and I ripped the ligaments in my arm here, and I thought, oh, you know, and then actually I was going preaching up in Canada, and so I got a sling and everything, and the airplane in the sling, and they didn't like that either. And anyway, I couldn't do anything. Well, I checked into it, and I guess I could have, for $10,000, I could have got it repaired, and they'd cut it off and attach something to my shoulder, and I'd be out of commission for doing anything for 6 months or something like that. And I said, well, I can still hit a golf ball, and I can still walk a little bit, and I think I'll just let it heal. You know, I'm not lifting weights, so that's what I did. But you know what? Guess what happened to I couldn't do anything with my arm. So I'm, for like months and months, I'm walking around, you know, lifting a pencil. Guess what happened to my bicep? Bye-bye. It's like gone. Just now, actually, in the last 6 months, I've had little tiny weights and trying to, I want to be able to lift a pencil, you know? Faith is like that. If you don't use that gift of faith, use what God gives you. And so, your testimony, great testimony, you exercised a gift of faith. Now keep working that muscle. Don't just believe God for that much. Believe God for the full meal deal. Keep believing God. Keep trusting Him. Keep going to Him. If you got to get desperate again, get desperate again. When you said, I got desperate, I thought, yes, yes, yes. Something happens when we go all in. So true faith has to change how we live. If you really believe something, you're going to operate different. It'll affect your thinking, yes. That's why it's the word, renewing your mind. But it will change what you do as well. It has to affect what you do. Of course, that's what James talks about. In fact, 1 Timothy 4:8 says, exercise in godliness is profitable in all things. So there's a benefit benefit in physical exercise, lots of benefit in spiritual exercise. Keep exercising your faith. Keep using that faith muscle. How do you do that? Let's say you get a headache. So the first thing you do is you go to God. Not the bottle, reaching for the bottle. And I take aspirin and stuff like that. I'm not anti that. But I want to go to God first. I want to exercise myself towards God. I want to say, Lord, I trust You. Go to God first, however big it is. You're just acknowledging the Lord in all your ways. You're saying, God, I'm putting my trust in You. Doesn't mean you don't go to doctors. Doesn't mean you don't take medicine if you need to take medicine. I'm not saying any of that. But let God be God in your life. Let him invade it. Invite Him to be part of everything you do. It should become a lifestyle. The just shall live by faith. Faith is also like a plant. So the good seed of the word is planted in there. The word of faith is planted in us. Then you got to water the seed, and you got to make sure you get lots of sunshine. That's S-O-N shine. Lots of sunshine for that seed to grow, and your faith will keep growing. It's back to being in the presence of God. I know I'm not telling you anything you don't know. But see, Jesus said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed. See, it's not the size or even the quantity of your faith. Just use the faith you have.
That's it.
Each time you exercise faith, and you're saying by your attitude, by your actions, and your mouth, Lord, You. Lord, I'm looking to You. Lord, You. Lord, I trust You. Lord, I'm calling on You. Seek God first. He says everything will be added. We're in a world that is trying to undermine our confidence and faith in God. Here's what the world is saying. You might recognize the voice of the original author. Hath God said. You get that? Genesis chapter 2. The serpent came. Chapter 3. Has God said? He's contending with Eve. Wait a minute. Has God really said that? Why was he attacking God's word? That's how you undermine faith, isn't it? You can't trust that. Yeah. Oh, sure, God said it, but cynicism, come on in. Come on, cynicism. Yeah, well, I pray, but it doesn't always work out. No, I trust in you, God. I may not understand why that prayer is not being answered here and now in this way, but I trust you. Because he's good, and he's loving, and there's nothing he can't do. He is the Almighty. So the third thing is a fight. Paul says in 2 Timothy 4, he says, I fought the fight of faith. I've kept the faith. I fought the good fight. Did you know it's a good fight? Good. Emphasis good. Underline good. It's a good fight. It is a good fight. Keep fighting for faith. Keep going after faith. Keep going after your relationship with God. Keep pressing God. Pressing after God. Keep pursuing him. Hebrews 11 says, verse 6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And you know, if you're a lover of Jesus, that's what you live for. You live to please the Father. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, that he exists, and that he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Keep pressing in. Keep going after God. So let me give you a Bible example of somebody that grew in faith in 1 Samuel 17. I'm sure you're familiar with this scripture. It's, anybody ever heard of Goliath? He's dead. And I'm going to tell how he got all dead. David's example is an example of growing in faith. So, I'm not going to read the whole passage because it's a big, big passage. But I'll give you the address to it. 1 Samuel 17, 31 through 51. That's 20 verses. I'm not going to read it all to you. But I encourage you to read it all because there's some nuggets in this passage about how David approaches this whole giant issue in his life. And you know what? I think it's an amazing picture for us. We have our giants, don't we? We got our battles, don't we? Well, I think we can look at David's example and grow in faith, grow in confidence in God. So, 1 Samuel 17, 34, let me frame this story. His brothers are in the army, they're warriors, and the Israelites and the Philistines are going to battle against one another. Well, the Philistines have this one massive guy named Goliath, and he had brothers, by the way, but they had a massive guy, Goliath. He's 9 feet tall. He's huge, and he's been trained as a warrior since he was a kid. So he's a serious warrior. Well, they're lined up on either side of this valley, Israelites on one side, Philistines on the other. So the big guy goes down and he hauls out, hey, listen, send out your best. He and I'll have a fight. Whoever wins the other armies, they're servants. The response in Israel? Terror. They're terrified. From big Saul. Saul was big too, not 9 feet big, but Saul was a head above everybody else. What was the response from the king on down? Terror. They were terrified. Fear gripped them. We have to see this battle of fear and faith. Faith is trusting God. Fear is not trusting God. They were terrified. And this went on. It became a daily routine. He'd come down there, hey, you slimy Israelites, where's your God? And yeah, blah, 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 and send out your best. Again, he's taunting them. So David's not even there. He's 17 years old. He's got red cheeks. He can't even grow a beard yet. He 17, taking care of the sheep. And he's not planning anything. He's taking care of the sheep, and that's his job. Well, his dad says, come here, I'm going to send you down, take some food down to the boys. They're getting ready to fight the Philistines. So take some food down to them, blah, blah, blah. And so he finds somebody to take care of the sheep for him, responsible guy. He goes down to the battle. And what just, how's this for lucky? I don't believe in luck. How's this for timing? Just as he gets there, Goliath is making his daily, hey, somebody, well, where's your God, you stupid Israelites? Send somebody out here to fight me, blah, blah, blah. That's not a quote, by the way. Just as David goes, listen to his first response. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine taunting the armies of God? Wait a minute, I thought they were the Israelites trembling in their tents, terrified. No, he says, he's taunting the armies of God. Here he comes out of shepherding the sheep, and he's got a spiritual perspective, a faith perspective. Instantly, he sees it through God's eyes. It was a spiritual battle. Can I tell you, your battle is a spiritual battle. It's not just circumstances. It's not just bad situations. It's not just physical issues. It's a spiritual. Look for the spiritual. So, Saul comes to him. Actually, Saul hears about it. And invites David to come to him. And let's look at 17:34. I'll read it to you. Saul, David says to him in verse 32, "Don't let anyone lose heart on account of this Philistine. I'll go." What? Thousands of Israelites, his brothers included, Saul the king, they're not going. No way. No, you go. No, you go. No, send somebody else. Let's send the kid. David the kid. Oh. And so he says to him, I'll go. He says, you're not able to fight against this Philistine. You're only a boy. He's been fighting since he was a boy. David says, Saul, now listen. Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. Now that's an encouragement. No, he goes, well, wait a minute. When a lion or a bear comes and carried off a sheep, I went after it, struck it down, rescued the sheep. And when it turned on me, I killed it. The Lord helped me. God helped me kill the lion. God helped me kill the bear. Giant? It's no problem. Oh, don't you love that kind of faith? I like to hang around people like that. Bear, lion, giants. No problem for God. See, his faith. When he thumped that lion, he knew it was God. And he hung on to it. Something settled in his spirit. Wow, God help me. I didn't just do that on my own. And then the bear comes, pow, nails the bear, goes, whoa, God's helping me out here. God, this couple of serious battles. I don't know. Last anybody here fought a lion or bear physically? We may have shot one from a long distance away. No, maybe it's probably more Bambi. But His faith was growing. So suddenly, there's this 9-foot intimidator up there cursing the God of the Jews, cursing these scaredy-cat Israelite warriors. I use the term loosely. And David comes filled with faith. He said, listen, your servant killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. It's spiritual. The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the bear and the paw of the lion will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. Don't you love that? So here's what I want to challenge you. God is taking you through circumstances to grow your faith. Every little victory or big victory, when you see God breaking through, you hang on to that. That's gold to you. That's spiritual pumping iron. Come on. You're pumping iron. So the next battle, you're going to be stronger. And you're going to say, you know, the Lord helped me with this. I'm going all the way with God. I'm going to put my trust in God. It's so funny. So he's this little 17-year-old guy with big faith. And Saul says, well, I got to give you something to fight him with. And so he puts his armor on him. Saul was a head above everybody else, and David is a little guy. And he puts his armor on him. He can't hardly walk with his armor. Gives him his sword. He's going, you know. Yeah. Praise God for David. David said, listen, I'm not used to this stuff. It ain't about the big sword or the armor. It's about the big faith. It's about the faith muscle that's getting strong. He said, I'll just take my stick and I'll find a couple rocks here somewhere. Yeah, that's usually what you do when you go to fight a 9-foot giant, right? Doesn't that sound logical? Let's just find some pebbles somewhere. You know, that's what in the... No, it's not about the pebbles or the stick. In fact, when he comes out to fight the giant goes, what? You're sending out kids to me with sticks? Am I a dog? He says, then he says to David, he curses his God and says, I'm going to feed you to the birds today. You got to hear David's response. Just, he's so filled with faith. It's in your face, giant. So let's look at it. Verse 45. David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin. That's the usual weapons of war. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. Yeah. The name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied this day. Don't you love it? Faith is now. Now faith is. It's right now. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. He's got 5 smooth stones and a stick. This day I'm cutting your head off. I like that kind of faith. Is he looking at circumstances? Is he looking at his own ability? Is he emotionally involved here? No, his faith is strong in God. He sees the battle for what it really is. David saw the battle from a spiritual perspective. I'm going to give you 6 things here. David saw the battle from a spiritual perspective. David saw a cause to fight for. This was the enemy versus the armies of God. That's a cause we want to fight for. A transformed life is a cause worth fighting for. Victory over darkness is a cause worth fighting for. Breaking the chains of addiction is a cause worth fighting for. Having a transformed life is a cause worth fighting for. Do you have a cause worth fighting for? Or are you willing to get desperate? That's a cause worth fighting for. Not everybody gets there. But when they do, breakthrough is not far away. His faith was built on facts. God had already helped him overcome other enemies. He spoke the language of faith. The word of faith was in his mouth. David knew that faith is now. You have to act on it. And he recognized whose the battle was. Listen in verse 47. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord says, for the battle is the Lord's. And he will give all of you, all of this army, into our hands. So how did he do it? So he starts going towards the battle, looks down in the brook, gets five nicely colored stones. And who knows what attracted him to those? They're smooth stones. I'd at least pick the pointed stone, something sharp to hurt the giant somewhere. You know, if I hit him in the leg, it cut his leg, and he go, oh, you know. No. Five smooth stones. Five smooth stones. He grabs the five, puts them in his bag. I hope he put one in, one good one in there. Come on. So here's the giant. What are you facing? What's your giant? So he takes his stick, and eventually he drops the stick. He grabs a stone out of his bag, and he's swinging the sling. And he runs towards the battle. Ah, if we can only figure that one out. When you got faith, you're not going to run from the battle. You run at the enemy because you know God is for you. You know the battle is the Lord's. You know that breakthrough is on its way. You know that God is big enough for this problem and this issue. And so he runs towards the giant, runs towards him. Now, this next part is my personal opinion. Five smooth stones. Do you think it mattered which one he picked out of the bag?
No.
You just grab the people. Could have been any one of the five smooth stones, right? Now, actually, I did a sermon one time about what those five smooth stones could be for us. Praise and different spiritual pebbles. But when he swung that sling and threw that rock, do you think maybe like the giant had a soft spot in his forehead? It was a smooth stone. How powerful was David? He's 17. Well, maybe he was pretty buff out there taking care of the sheep, right? That's a hard job. Maybe not his buffness. What in the world was it when he threw that rock, it drove it into the giant's head, killed him instantly. It didn't knock him back. He fell forward. It wasn't no pebble. It was not a sling, the slingshot. The battle is the Lord's. God dropped that giant. God took him down. I am absolutely convinced God took that giant and hit him, the rock hit him in the forehead. God was pushing the giant's head into the rock. Boom! He went down face first. That was a spiritual thing. It was a spiritual thing. So now David has already expressed his confidence. I'm going to take your head off with a sword. Well, he doesn't have a sword. He dropped his stick to run. Runs up to the giant and takes his own sword and whacks his head off. God provided everything David needed to win the battle. God provided everything. I'm preaching to you about your giants. What are you facing? What do you need from God? What has become a giant in your life? What are your battles? First, find out what God says about it. Get a hold of God. Get God's perspective on the battle. That means hang out with God. Get close, draw close. Draw near to Him, He'll draw near to you. God will begin to give you heaven's perspective on this earthly battle. And I guarantee what will happen. God will speak. And you can hang your hat on that. God will begin to stir faith in you. And you say, yes, I know. God is for me. No matter how big the battle is, God can break through. No matter how discouraged I've been in the past, God can overcome this. No matter what I'm facing, God is bigger than this giant.
Yes, thank you, God.
Finally, as you speak like God, you say what He says, then you got to do what He tells you to do. You got to run at your giants. Don't run from them. Don't lose heart. Don't give up. Don't be like the rest of the army back there, shaking in their tents. You run towards your giants and believe that God's going to bring you breakthrough. For this I know, God is for you. God is with you. God is for you. And nothing is impossible with God. So will you pray with me? If you can be honest enough to admit that there's some giants, some battles in your life that you need some victory in, you need some breakthrough in, would you just lift a hand to heaven and let the Lord know that you need His help. You need His help. You need breakthrough. Father, you see every hand. And they're saying, by faith, God, I believe in you. I believe, help my unbelief, make me stronger in faith. Lord, I pray for an infusion of faith. Lord, that you would strengthen their faith muscle. And Lord, we are bringing these giants to you. In the name of the Lord, they're going to go down. In the name of the Lord, they're going to be overthrown. Breakthrough, a deliverance from addiction, deliverance from fear. Fear go in the name of Jesus. Addiction be broken. Spirit of addiction, go now in Jesus' name. Bring release, Father, I pray. For every giant, physical illnesses, Lord. Yes, yes, infirmity, go now in Jesus' name. The strength of the Lord is our strength. The strength of the Lord is our strength. The strength of the Lord is our strength. We have the life of God in us. We have the life of God in us, in whom is no sickness, no disease, no infirmity. We have the life of God in us. In Jesus' name. For the glory and for the honor and for the admiration of Jesus Christ. You've done all these things. In Jesus' name. Can I take a minute and share some prophetic stuff? We got time?
Yes.
Got 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Hi, are you? my church, I always do this, but it may not be necessary here. Sometimes God will give us impressions in our spirit. And we're listening to the voice of the Spirit, like Pastor Dave when he was talking, sharing about words of knowledge, about different areas of healing. The Holy Spirit pressed into his spirit, and those words or phrases, sometimes things he didn't even know what they were, but God was telling him things that he wanted to do in this gathering. And sometimes God gives me impressions, and so I'll pick somebody out and share it with them. I just want to give you permission, if I point to you and you're not comfortable with that, that's all right. You can say, no, I'm just not comfortable with you sharing anything with me. And I haven't had too many, but I've had some people that aren't, that's just outside of their frame of reference. And that's fine. I won't be offended if you say no, please. And I also want to say, before I pray for some people, that God's very gracious, and He's not going to shame you.
Amen.
or expose garbage. He's the most loving being I know in the universe. So can I, what's your name?
Me.
Right here.
Oh, Sophia.
Sophia?
Yes.
Can I share something with you? Sophia, you are a doer. You are a person, not much dust settles around you because you are go, 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 go. You're a very active person. What's funny, I'm mentioning dust, but I see like there's dust all around you, and yet you're on the move because you're involved with people's lives. In fact, you have a great compassionate heart. You love to serve others. It wasn't always that way. There was a time in your life where you experienced some real brokenness and you felt like the only answer was to hide away. But God's brought you out of that. I can see a lot of healing in your spirit. God has replaced the sorrow for joy, with joy. And so you're a celebrator. In fact, I'm sure it bugs some people around. I think you have lots of family around you, and some people they don't quite know how to handle you, because you like spill out all over the place. Keep spilling out. That's the joy of the Lord, and the Holy Spirit is drawing them. They may scratch their heads. They may even complain, but they really love what they're seeing happening inside of you. So keep spilling joy everywhere you go. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay, good. What's your name?
Scott.
Scott, can I share with you? Is this your wife?
Yes, it is.
And you're?
Weeda.
Weeda? Can I share with both of you?
Please.
All right. Boy, you are such a loyal friend. You are, the verse that came, that popped in my head was, iron sharpens iron. There's something about you, there's a loyalty, when you make friends, you like give them the shirt off your back and then some. There's just, you're true blue. And the Lord wants to commend you, because that's the very nature of God, is that heart of generosity. Sometimes you give too much, and she lets you know, doesn't she? But you know what? God has blessed the two of you. You are generous, and you look for the hurting and the broken. And you have a special compassion and a heart. Sister, there's a gift.
Weeda.
Weeda. Yeah. Weeda, there's a gift of mercy in you as well. In fact, I can see you like a nurse caring for hurting, the broken. There's a great compassion in you. Now you're also, I also think I see you like with lots of numbers in front of you, and you're making sure to add things up, and you want to make sure that is right, and it really bugs you if it doesn't balance. And what's that? Oh yeah, well, at the end of the day, it really bugs you if it doesn't balance. But you're a people person too. Interesting. It's an interesting mix of both. You're a bit of a perfectionist, but because you like things done right, and you know, and you have a good sense of what is right. But you also care about people. Do you guys have kids? No kids?
Well, they all have four legs.
Four-legged kids. I don't want to prophesy to them. I saw extended family that you're impacting, that you're influencing. I just want to encourage you. There's a couple knuckleheads in that bunch that God is working to draw them into the kingdom. Keep loving on them. Don't let their knuckleheadedness make you push them away, because sometimes it's hard to be around knuckleheads, isn't it? And keep loving it. Love them past knuckleheadedness. I'm just making this word up. Is that a real word? Anyway, I just want you to know, I think God is really delighted in the two of you, that you're involved with people. You're people. And I encourage you to keep make sure the dogs are can be hospitable, as well as your home to be a hospitable place, and have lots of people over, because your home is a safe place to be. What's your name, brother?
Abel.
Abel?
Yeah.
All right. Boy, that's a good name. Yeah. Abel, I see you as a very determined person. You have picked yourself up out of dire circumstances in the past, and the Lord, you're really a testimony of God's grace. There was at least, I'm getting at least two times that you thought, "This is it. I'm done. It's near death experiences." And you know God has preserved your life. Your life is a testimony to the preservation power of God. And I just want to tell you, Abel, God is calling you to influence others more and more. Don't be silent. You've got a great testimony. You've got a great message of hope to hopeless people. Don't be silent. There's a reserve side of you. And that would tend to make you pull back and not be as vocal. But I'm feeling like the Lord is urging you. Tell your story. Tell your story. It's gonna impact people for good. Some people may not like it, but that's gonna be the small side. Most people are gonna say, wow, that's amazing what God has done for Abel. God can do it for me. So keep sharing that word. I want to encourage you, get in God's word, because as you're sharing your story, make sure to add nuggets of truth, because the word of God won't return void. Our stories are important, but the word of God is eternal. The word is the seed. So tell your story, but sow the seed, because that's going to have eternal benefit. All right. What's your name? Yes.
Suzanne,
can I share with you? The first phrase that comes to my mind is, you're a helper. You help lots of people. You're a person that, the scripture that talks about the Holy Spirit, it says he's a comforter. He comes alongside. That's what that word means, comforter. You come alongside people. Which means you're a great friend, but there's a loyalty in you. And I think you help some people that can't help themselves. You come alongside of them. You don't have a judgmentalism in you. You accept people just as they are. Maybe that's because from the past that others mistreated you in the past and devalued. And actually, there's the phrase in my mind is, they treated you like a castaway. But the Lord says, you're not a castaway. From the day you were conceived, I saw you. I have pursued you. I have loved you. And even when you felt your loneliest and your emptiest, the Lord says, I was there and watching over you and preserving you. And that comforting, that come alongside part of you that is such a strong part of your personality, it's the character of Jesus. It's the nature of Jesus. So I think you're a hugger. That's what come alongside people do. They hug people and include them in their circle of love. And so I want to encourage you to keep including others, keep embracing others, and keep valuing others with your words especially. Interesting, some people I've ministered to, it was like they have this telephone ministry, or they talk, but you're not like that. You don't talk all the time, and so you weigh your words, so your words actually have more weight. When you say something, you're thinking through it, and you're saying it more carefully, and so your words have greater weight than those that talk all the time, and you're not quite sure what they're saying because they talk so much. Okay. I especially want to pray for a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit on you, because God wants to empower you to I believe there's that God wants to release his power in you in a greater measure in the days ahead and give you healing in your hands and action and impartation when you comfort others. Are you willing to be prayed for that?
Yes.
Okay. Lord, in Jesus' name, I just pray for a greater anointing. Lord, pour out on our sister and let that anointing, that healing anointing flow through our hands. Lord, I pray this week, give her somebody that needs a healing, needs a touch, and let her in faith just reach out and lay hands on them. And Lord, let those hugs just impart encouragement and confidence in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Pastor Dave, I think that's it. Thanks for letting me come and provoke you. Church filled with faith, and I'm stirring up your faith. Thanks.
Hallelujah. Wow.